If you are sitting at home next to your radio, you're hearing the music faster than you are if you're in the hall.
Listening for the secret, searching for the sound. This is the Sound Podcast with Ira Haberman.
True friend. That was My Only True Friend from Gregg Allman's unfortunate final record, Southern Blood, released posthumously recently, months after his passing. The day Gregg left us, I was personally rocked, having grown up listening to the Allman Brothers Band, meeting Gregg on a couple of occasions, and seeing him not only with the brothers, but also the Gregg Allman Band. His legacy and work will live on as one of the finest blues vocalists and musicians we will ever know. We sat down with Michael Lehman, Gregg's manager, to learn more about the Southern Blood project, and indeed, Gregg Allman.
Gregg had become not only a client of mine, but a dear, dear friend over the years, and we always looked forward to spending time together, and fortunately, I got to spend a lot of time with him, and especially as we got close towards the end of his life, so I cherished every single one of those moments, and you know, now celebrating this record, and is so bittersweet, obviously, because I see his face in front of me every day. I hear his voice. I see this music. And then sometimes I just, you know, look at a magazine cover or some pictures, and I start talking to him because I can't even believe that he's not here and that, you know, I'm helping him in this way. And I know he's looking down on us, but it is, you know, bittersweet. It's a happy time. It's a sad time. There's a flood of different emotions that run through on a daily basis.
Do you think, though, that putting this record out and, you know, doing it in such a respectful way kind of brings closure to a certain degree to what was an unbelievable career? You know, he touched so many people's lives, not just in the music industry, but, you know, being sort of a pop, I don't want to say a pop icon, but certainly somebody who was known in pop culture for, you know, some of the things that he did. How should we say this? On and off the field?
Right, exactly. Well, it is his last studio recording. There are no more studio tracks. He did write a little bit towards the end of his life, but nothing that was recorded at all. I think, you know, there was the start of his solo career, which was the laid back record, also probably one of his finest solo works, and then bookending with Southern Blood. I hate to say that it brings closure because I know the music is going to live on for a long, long time, and hopefully, you know, the future generations who seem to be embracing this project, but I guess in a way, yeah, there is some finality to it all with this record that, you know, is, you know, really one of Gregg's finest masterpieces without question.
Let's talk a bit about the record, because what I find so intriguing about it is that you can be, or Gregg could be, introspective without actually writing his own songs. I mean, this is a collection of songs that obviously meant a lot to him, and that certainly comes through in some of his song selections. Were there songs that you were hesitant to put on the record, or that Don was hesitant to cut, just in terms of how they fit in the bigger scheme of things?
So Gregg clearly was one of the great master interpreters of music and different songs, Gregg had been diagnosed with a reoccurrence of his liver cancer back in 2012, which was just about the time that we were starting to think about a follow-up record to Low Country Blues. And initially, Gregg was thinking about coming out with a record of all original compositions, and then that direction changed for a multitude of reasons, illness being one of it, and Gregg wanting to really spend time on the road and with his fans versus hold up in writing sessions for, you know, what could have been weeks or months on end. Around 2014 and 15, we started to have more serious conversations and went ahead and hired Don Was to produce Southern Blood, and started kicking around through different meetings that we were having with Gregg and myself and Don Was and his manager, Larry Jenkins. We started kicking around the different types of songs and songwriters that Gregg was interested in. You know, specifically, Gregg, you know, was a huge Tim Buckley fan, and you know, Little Feet and Lowell George Band. So he was able to pinpoint certain songs exactly to say, hey, I want to cover these songs. And then as with the small group, we then also probably created about a list of 100 tracks that Gregg listened to, Scott Sherrard, our music director, listened to some of them, and they just sort of fell into Gregg's lap in a way that that made sense. And you know, there was the inner circle of Gregg and Chank Middleton, his closest friend, and myself, that were fully aware of where he was in his life's journey. But other than that, he really didn't share much with anyone. And I think without even fully realizing it at the time, Gregg, as well as all of us, were putting songs together that would allow him to sing about his life and his career and what he was looking forward to, which was unfortunately going to be the untimely death.
How important was it for him to go back to Muscle Shoals to record this record? I mean, I understand that, you know, back where it all began is an interesting way to put it, but in many ways it was back where it all began. That's where Dwayne kind of emerged as this brilliant guitar player, and certainly was brilliant in the studio, but the Allman Brothers sound certainly emerged, and one could argue Southern rock emerged from those early days at Fame. And how important was it for Gregg to go back to Fame and record in Muscle Shoals?
So it was intensely important when we moved forward after Low Country Blues. Gregg gave me two mandates. One was that he insisted on recording the follow-up record with his solo band, the Gregg Allman Band, because he didn't do that on Low Country Blues. We used a, you know, incredible group of studio musicians. And two, he insisted upon going back to Muscle Shoals. And again, he knew where he was in his life's journey. Muscle Shoals is so hallowed, right? And those walls contain so much great music and history, and some of that just wears off on you. We had been a part of the Muscle Shoals documentary and actually went out and promoted it a little bit, went to the Sundance Film Festival in London and did an event in New York. And so Gregg had reconnected actually with Rick Hall, and we met Rodney Hall, which was Rick's son. And Gregg was sold after looking at that film and thinking about it that this is where I need to go back to and record this record. It's where, you know, Dwayne really got his start, where the Hourglass, one of Gregg's and Dwayne's early bands, recorded some demo sessions. And you know, he said, Michael, in today's day and age, which I know also from the Village Recorder and so many other studios, you get the best of both worlds. You get to record on an old analog board that is so rich and full of, you know, special sound on a 2-inch reel, and then you can mix digitally. So why wouldn't I want to do that? Because it would go so well with my voice. And I'm like, you're right. And it took a while because Muscle Shoals was in the midst of a restoration project where they were fixing up the studio and improving it a little. And so we had to wait for that to finish. And then we had to deal with some of Gregg's health issues and some touring schedules and Don's schedule. So it took until March the 16th until we were finally able to go in there to record Southern Blood.
It really was his final project then. I mean, if it was March of 2016, that's, you know, a year and a half ago. That's really something. How difficult, how taxing was the health condition on what was going on post Low Country Blues? I mean, you know, I would imagine it was a tough road to hoe, but he certainly wanted to do that, right? Be on the road for as much as he could after Low Country Blues.
Absolutely. So it was taxing. And so what we did was we adjusted his touring schedule. Instead of doing 5 shows a week, which is traditionally what so many artists do and what Gregg liked to do, he loved, you know, he didn't want to waste time when he was out there. He loved to play for the fans as well as you know, on the economics of touring, you know, it's an expensive proposition. But we adjusted down to 4 shows a week. He started spending much more time in his hotel room, so he would really rest up the entire day and conserve the energy for the 2 to 3 hours that he would be on stage with his fans, and then go back to the hotel and rest and do it all over again the following night. He also changed his diet significantly, was doing a lot of juicing and really trying to eat healthier, and you know, because he wanted to be out on the road. What started to happen, though, after this diagnosis in 2012, where he really was only given 12 to 18 months to live, and ultimately he ended up getting 5 years, he focused heavily on being out there, and we were laser focused on picking territories that weren't always places that we had played before, rooms that we hadn't played before, and it was important to him to play in small rooms, medium sized rooms, and big rooms.
Right.
He also got involved with philanthropy, and we set up 2 scholarships, one at the University of Georgia and their music school, and one at Syracuse University and their music industry school. Mm-hmm. And we created a festival model. And part of the reason for creating all these different opportunities was so that if there was a time that Gregg wanted to slow down but remain active, the festivals were a way to do that, where he didn't necessarily have to perform in our laid-back festivals, named after, you know, the laid-back record, but he could show up and introduce some of the artists, or, you know, just meet and greet with fans. And, you know, philanthropy allowed him to go visit the campuses and meet the scholarship recipients. So there was a lot of richness that was had come into Gregg's life towards the end. And then I'd say starting around probably really the beginning of 2016, a little before the record, on our holiday run leading into the record, and then certainly into the, you know, latter part of spring and summer, we unfortunately started having to postpone and cancel some dates, and, you know, health issues were creeping up on him.
I have to ask, because his name is Gregg Allman, and he was a part of the Allman Brothers Band, obviously. Did the Allman Brothers Band going south there near the end really disappoint him, and that's why he was so focused on doing right by the fans with the solo project? I mean, I don't want to get into the nitty gritty of the politics or the probably very personal conversations Gregg had around the Allman Brothers and their last, you know, Beacon run, but, you know, how taxing was that emotionally on him? And then was sort of spending time on the solo project his way out, his release from what became in the end of the Allman Brothers Band project?
Yep. So from the early 70s, from 73, Gregg had started his solo career. And I think you're right. So probably from about 2009, a year before Gregg had his liver transplant, through 2014, which was the final shows of the Allman Brothers on their 45th anniversary, there had become, you know, more of a push and pull. Some of the other artists, you know, Derek and Susan and Warren, were interested in spreading their wings, and you know, rightfully so. They all loved the brothers, but they also wanted to do some of their own things. Honestly, Gregg also felt the same way. Gregg actually loved both bands equally. He loved playing with the Allman Brothers, and then, you know, by the time that he was getting tired of that and looking forward to being out with his solo band, that gave him that outlet. And then again, a few months later, when he was a little tired of the solo band, all of a sudden some brothers dates would come along. So he sort of looked at it that he had the best of both worlds. Right. When the brothers finally hung it up after 45 years in 2014, and you're right, there were some struggles there towards the end, I think Gregg was relieved, because it gave him the time that he wanted to put together and make the final cuts and additions to what would be, in his mind, his best solo band ever. it allowed him to focus on, you know, creating a new body of work. And honestly, in 2014, Gregg and I had talked about that hopefully he had three or four records left in him. We didn't realize that this was going to be the final one because he had, you know, he was the guy that had 99 lives that had already skated by so many times. So we thought there would be more there. So we were thinking we would create a body of work similar to what Johnny Cash did towards the end of his career and life. And so Gregg was really happy. And I have to share with you, you know, I was fortunate enough to attend so many of the Allman Brothers shows and Gregg shows, solo shows. I would look over after they had retired and watch him from the side of the stage, and he would look, and he was like a proud parent looking at his band with a big smile on his face, because this was the band he always wanted. He always wanted a horn section. He wanted the percussionist and drums. He wanted everything that he had there on stage, he had, and he also wanted to go back to playing the songs in a more structured way, in the way that he had originally written them before, you know, the Allman Brothers did their own number on them with stretching them out and, you know, longer drum solos and guitar solos. So he was actually happy to be able to spend some quality time with his solo band, recreating the sound that he had originally thought of when he wrote these songs.
How important was Scott Sherrard, not only in this project, but keeping things going as the musical director through those last, you know, four years or 3 years, really?
Scott was great. I mean, honestly, the whole band was a family, but I would say Scott had a way of approaching the musicians so they would, in a very respectful way, so that they would actually follow his direction and lead, because Gregg never really wanted to mess with that part of it. And he also had a way of speaking with Gregg and interpreting what Gregg was looking for. So, you know, he was a great addition. He joined the band 10 years prior to Gregg's death this year. So we had 10 years with Scott and was our music director for four of those 10 years. And he really did help bring this cohesive unit together. He had a great way of proposing set lists and what would work right. He understood what the fans were looking for, because the truth is, you know, when you see a more iconic act, typically, you know, as a consumer and a fan, you want to hear the greatest hits. You may want to hear one or two new ones, but you certainly don't want to hear half the show of new songs. So Scott knew how to balance that to keep Gregg happy, who was always looking to stretch out a little bit, as well as keep the fans happy. So he was an integral part of the group and a great guy and you know, a good friend to all.
Scott Sherrard not only played an integral part in the onstage presence of the Gregg Allman Band, but he also contributed songs to the band's repertoire. One of those songs was Love Like Kerosene, which made its way onto Southern Blood. I want to ask about Butch's passing because really there were three icons that we lost, you know, that were all part of, well, I would say Colonel Bruce less so, but still part of that Atlanta and that Southern sound in many ways. But, you know, we lost Butch and Colonel Bruce and Gregg really all within months of each other. And it was, I know a lot of people were shook by, you know, Teal Burbage was very shook by it, and lots of musicians and the community as a whole was really shook by it. But I'm curious about, you know, Gregg's feelings around Butch's passing, and just, again, another kind of one of those signposts that the past is, you know, kind of behind him, you know?
Yeah. Obviously they go back to when they were teenagers, the two of them, and he was very, very sad, and I would almost have to leave it at that I'm going to share a little more, but when I found out that Butch had passed so suddenly, obviously and tragically.
Yeah.
I called Gregg, and Gregg has dealt with so much tragedy over his years, and I wasn't with him personally, and I was very worried to call him because, you know, Gregg was a people person and a lover of life and humanity and of wildlife and animals, and never wanted to see anyone harmed. And I had to call Gregg and give him this news, and he was dead silent. He didn't say a word. You know, he just said, wow, probably three times. And then I let it breathe for about an hour, and I called Gregg back, and he was very, very sad and quiet and a little emotional and wanted to know what happened, and I had to share the unfortunate news, and he took it really hard, but he took it privately and just was felt so sad. I mean, it's obviously anytime someone takes their life, there's so much pain involved, and I never and Gregg never thought of it as something that was selfish, which I know, you know, many people look at that, it could be a selfish act. Mm-hmm. Gregg felt it was just, you know, that he must have been in so much pain and suffering, even though he seemed so good, you know, up until days before. I mean, he seemed, you know, very happy from all the reports that we heard. So he took it really, really hard, and I think, you know, if there had been, because there had been some conversations back and forth about possibly getting together again for the 50th anniversary.
Right.
And, you know, if that ever was going to happen, all of those plans were really shattered upon Butch's passing.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, if you think about all of the people that were involved in the brothers and then just in Gregg's life in a more general way, I mean, he had to deal with not only his own nine lives, but certainly the nine lives of the band and all of its members and the greater community. It's actually, when you stand back and think about it, and you've certainly had time to reflect in that way, it's quite staggering. So thank you for sharing that. I do appreciate it, and I'm sure those listening do as well. My Only True Friend is a tribute certainly to his brother and to the music that he's made, and Southern Blood is a really tribute to his life, and so thank you for taking the time to share it and create it with him. And it was such an important record, obviously, for Gregg, but now an even more important record for the rest of us. So thank you so much for taking the time today and for helping create what will be a lasting legacy of his work and his sound. And there aren't too many people. There weren't too many people alive like Gregg, and there certainly won't be for a while. So thank you. Thank you for.
Thanks so much, Ira. I appreciate it.
Before we leave you, I wanted to share one more track from the Southern Blood record. It conjures up the Muscle Shoals scene where the record was created, and the performance is heartfelt, as all of Gregg's performances were. But for me, the honest retelling of this Hunter Garcia classic is genuine and clearly one that was important for Gregg to perform. Black Muddy River Roll on.
When the last rose of summer pricks my finger and the hot sun chills me to the bone, when I can't hear the song for the singer, I can't tell my pillow from a stone. I will walk alone by the black, muddy river, sing me a song of my own. I will walk alone by the black, muddy river, sing me a song of my own. When the last bolt of sunshine hits the mountain and the stars start to splatter in the sky, when the moon hits the southwest horizon with the scream of an eagle on the fly, I will walk alone by the black, muddy river, listen to the ripples as they moan. I will walk alone by the black, muddy river, sing me a song of my own. Black muddy river,
you've been listening to The Sound Podcast. Technical production by Adam Karsh and Andrea Ruse. Inspired by the Grateful Dead and you, their fans. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe on your favorite podcast platform. And find us at thesoundpodcast.com.